Hi, what's this? It's not a series. No, it's not even Watcher Weekly, but it sort of feels like that. You can find all that over on patreon.com. This is a one-off video where we're gonna guess, I think, Gen Z slang, a thing that we don't know about because we're all elderly now.
I will say I'm the youngest of the group, so I think I have an advantage here.
Are you?
Barely, yeah. Like 2 weeks younger than I am.
I don't know about that. I think it's more like a month.
But I think we're all equally out of touch.
You might remember that we tried this on Watcher Weekly and it didn't go too well.
Have they come up with new words since then?
I'm sure they have.
Okay.
And so we've brought over our Gen Z rep, Simone.
Hello, I'm Simone. I'm a social media coordinator and watcher. And I would also call myself an active participant in internet culture. And I was also born in 2000, so.
I'm gonna need to see a birth certificate.
You don't even remember 9/11?
You're gonna have whiteboards, and I'm gonna tell you either a word or an emoji that Gen Z uses frequently in very specific meaning. You're gonna either have to use a definition or use the words correctly in a sentence. The one who gets it correctly gets a point, and the one with least amount of points has to say a statement that we prepared that they strongly disagree with.
This is tough because I feel like I'm a classically book smart kind of guy, but
oh boy.
Gen Z is all about that street smart.
I don't think I've used a new word since 2011.
But you're TikTok king.
I am TikTok king. Yeah. That's true.
First round, we're gonna go into words and phrases. The first word is caught in 4K.
In 4K?
What's that noise? Oh, it's my fucking phone looking it up. Just kidding.
Shall we?
I'm not done.
Yeah, I don't know what the hell is that guy doing over there. Guy thinks he's writing an episode of Puppet History. See the runtime on those bad boys.
I'm ready.
I'll begin. My answer is Ryan Bergara's murder of the professor was caught in 4K.
Now that seems very literal.
The Gen Z crowd, they are a literal bunch.
I put giving reverence to things that don't necessitate that. Like, here's my dog taking a shit, caught in 4K.
I said, when you've got, like, definitive proof of something, i.e., I noticed someone had been eating my sardines from the pantry, and the other day I saw grandma tucking into a tin. Caught her ass in 4K.
I think that actually sounds about right.
Caught in 4K in general means that you expose someone and you have a proof or evidence of them doing something wrong on social media usually. To find like an example myself, we had a live stream on Patreon and Ryan accidentally leaked the new season of Are You Scared on his desktop.
This is so funny. Oh wait, did I share the right screen?
No, nope. You didn't. Close it. Well.
But I would say Shane definitely got it the best. Steven got the spirit. Ryan was kind of gone in a completely different direction.
You know, I love language.
Oh God, this guy gets 1 point. He's already talking like he's won the championship.
I love language.
So the word number two, endgame.
Like the Marvel film.
How could that not be taken literally?
Mine are the most boring, so I'll start. Ryan Bergara's endgame was evident the moment he started being nice to the professor. I think we can say that I nailed the definition.
Yeah, I just put we're in the endgame now.
Quoting the film.
Yeah,
that's right,
yeah.
And then I put,
that's the final move you got for a master plan.
I said, like when something is a foregone conclusion, i.e. grandma accidentally drank a full bottle of Windex, endgame.
Well, none of you got it right. Endgame means when two characters are canonically together by the end of a movie or series.
Ryan the Professor, come on, that's a love story.
Just holding up your board doesn't make it more right.
Okay, so the next phrase you have to explain is main character syndrome.
We'll start with the correct and boring answer. When an individual thinks that the world revolves around them and has little to no self-awareness, that they are literally 1 in 7 billion. Okay.
Damn, dude.
Ryan Bergara's deal with the devil was clearly a case of main character syndrome.
When someone assumes all things in the world that happen pertain to their storyline or life or whatever.
Yeah, mine's also similar. When someone's selfish or a bit narcissistic and doesn't consider other people, i.e., grandma made me clean the slugs out of the shed while her lazy ass just sat there sipping a Coors Banquet. Main character syndrome shaking my damn head.
Okay. There was a lot to unpack here. Main character syndrome in general means If it's in your point of view that you're romanticizing your life, so like when you're sitting on a bus alone and you're listening to music and then you're staring out of the window and you just pretend that you're the main character and everyone is kind of like the background character. I feel like Steven was the closest, but in this case, I would probably give points to everyone.
This is gonna be very confusing to people who have never seen puppet history before.
That's fine. Watch the fucking show. Welcome to Watcher.
Talk about main character syndrome.
Another word is manifesting.
Manifesting.
Okay.
Do we get points for like longest answer? Because somebody over here is trying to suck up to the teacher.
That's Shane Madej. He's a lot of things, but he's not known for his brevity.
No, okay.
All right, let's do this. Manifesting, when a coincidence happens in your favor, but everyone says it was meant to be. Like, wow, found $100 in my coat pocket. Good times manifesting.
I've never found $100 in my pocket. That sounds exciting.
Yeah, I found like $5.
Yeah,
you finding $100 in your pocket regularly?
You know what he does? He pockets all those desserts from Worth It and then he just sells them on eBay.
I knew it. I fucking knew it. This is a pretty boilerplate here. To bring a desire or want to fruition by constantly telling yourself it will happen, i.e. Ryan manifested a puppet history victory.
So mine's pretty similar to that. Putting it out there into the universe that you want something to happen, i.e. our mailman Chester winked at grandma when she brought him a Pepsi. Do I hear wedding bells? OMFG, manifesting.
Got a weird obsession with grandmas, man. I don't know what's going on in your life, but.
You're doing great. I would give my point to Ryan and Shane because manifesting means that you're like trying to think of something so much that it happens in real life, so.
That's not Gen Z.
It
is. Here we go.
Oh boy, here we go.
That's the dictionary definition of manifesting.
Yeah, but you can like make it more Gen Z with like candle emojis all over it.
I was going to mention the candle emojis. Do I get extra credit for that? The tweets with the candle emojis.
This one is my favorite personally. Girl boss.
Girl boss. All right, I'll begin. A state in which an individual has peaked and become the best version of themselves, i.e. Simone's goals. What a girl boss.
Now you just, oh my God, you're just this guy.
Hey, dude, you got a little something on your nose there. Now that's some millennial humor. Anyways, when a girl does some boss ass shit and takes control, like I girl bossed my way into that sweet ass promotion would be what I would say if I was a girl boss. Alas, I am not.
I think there might be some history to this. So I said, I get the vibe that it initially meant to signify some kind of professional empowerment, but now points to more toxic behavior of someone who uses their own empowerment as an excuse to sort of push other people out of their way for their own benefit. But I don't know, my example is, grandma's such a girl boss sometimes, shaking my damn head.
Airing some shit out.
I don't know, but I feel like I've seen it used more negatively recently.
Girl boss, in general, means you're doing something in a feminist way, but more in the toxic territory, as Shane said. You have the famous line that says, gaslight, gatekeep, girl boss.
All negative, bad
things. That's like a toxic live, laugh, love. And Shane definitely gets a point. Ryan and Steven, however, I don't see it. The next one we have is pick me girl.
Okay, you can start.
All right.
Jesus Christ,
pick me girl. Term used to describe the lady in the schoolyard that you pick last for sports but ends up dominating all the boys.
Yeah, I'm putting my own spin on this too. I just put any of those bros on The Bachelorette, i.e. yo, that rose looks juicy, pick me girl. It's a good show.
I said, I guess like someone who tries too hard, a la a student in class who quickly raises their hand and says, pick me, i.e. grandma flaunting that new halter top for Chester the mailman. Yo, he already likes you. Don't be such a pick me girl. Shaking my damn head. And then in quotes though, I said, not necessarily romantic or flirtatious. Sort of just a try hard.
Pick me girl usually means that a girl is trying to claim that she's not like the other girls. She doesn't fit in, she doesn't want to fit in, she's different.
Like she wears a halter top for the mailman. What's a halter top?
I would say that Shane was the closest out of all of you. Stevens was really wholesome, even though it was wrong. The final word we have is go touch some grass.
All right, I'll start off with the accurate definition here. A phrase spoken to people who have spent far too long on technology and need to disconnect from their phone. That dude's been playing Minecraft for 72 hours. Needs to go touch some grass.
There's grass in Minecraft.
Digital grass.
That's what I'm saying, though. It's like, it's not real, though. That's why.
You ever play that in VR? Oh my God.
Touching grass?
It's like you don't ever want to leave.
You know, when you're just fucking jonesing for a juicy ass joint. Like, man, I'm trying to get absolutely fucking barbecued. You trying to go touch some grass?
That's good. Mine's similar to Steven's, though it's not technology-based. Mine says, like, ground yourself, snap out of it, come to your senses and calm down, i.e., grandma thinks Chester won't go on a date with her because her shed's full of slugs, but I'm like, go touch some grass, me ma, hear a perfect smoking 10 shaking my damn head.
Go touch some grass in general means that you should go outside when you spend too much time online, and then you're fighting people about just stuff that it just doesn't make sense to like fight about things like that.
It's like log off. Log the fuck off.
Yeah, so I would give the points to Steven.
Woo! And now a word from our sponsor. HelloFresh! HelloFresh provides conveniently pre-portioned ingredients, which means less prep for you and less wasted food. They also have a huge variety of items to choose from every week, including vegetarian and gourmet options. All right, let's unbox this. Everything is prepackaged in bags. Which one shall we do today? Why don't we go with the citrus pork tacos? I'm feeling a little bit of taco time. My parents are in town right now. Haven't had time to grocery shop. I'm just like, not sure what to do. So actually I ordered HelloFresh and it's so easy. And they're like, wow, Steven, you can cook? Like, yeah, dude, have you not seen Dish Granted? Their marketplace features a variety of add-ons for breakfast, desserts, and seasonal snacks. And they can make your holiday this year a lot easier since their weekly delivery can help you cut back on both meal prep and cleanup. Go to HelloFresh.com and use our code WATCHER14 to get 14 free meals and 3 free gifts. That's right, 14 free meals, 3 free gifts. Use our code WATCHER14. And now, back to the show.
Now we're gonna move into part 2 of this video, which are emojis. This is a sparkle emoji, but used in a way when you have a sparkle emoji, then you have a word, and then you end the word with another sparkle emoji.
Used to emphasize a glow up. Just caught my first car, my 1995 Ford Taurus.
When someone just makes your life sparkle, like that special someone, like me to Justin Herbert, the best quarterback in the fucking league.
I do know.
That's obviously what that means.
This feels too literal. I just said when you're reverent of something, like grandma got a tiara from Walmart and she looks pristine.
The sparkle emoji, that is something extra, it's something dramatic. So I always, for example, say, I don't take pictures, I perform. And when you say the perform word, you just put it in between the sparkles, you just spice it up. But I don't think any of you kind of like hit the mark with this one.
And that's so. Fine.
That's fine. That's fair. Fine.
My example, I should have just stuck with the example.
Yeah, you probably would have gotten it.
Yeah.
But then you had to keep talking.
Another set of emojis are the handwriting emojis.
Yes.
This guy over here, you know. My answer. Used to describe someone who talks or writes so much that it is sus. Shane, dot, dot, dot.
Taking notes for later use, i.e. like receipts, if you will.
Oh, interesting, that was, right? Interesting, I like that one.
Here's an example, like I were to see, like Ryan will never win at Puppet History, and I would respond with the little notes emoji. I remembered that.
Well, we all live with the choices we made. I said, I guess maybe if you see something of value or import and are, quote, taking notes as if heeding some pointers or advice for the future, Chester now talking to neighbor Diane, grandma losing footing. Watch and learn from Diane, grandma. Notes, notes, notes.
So the handwriting emoji in general means that you're taking notes, and usually it is used in between words. So one sentence can have like multiple handwriting emojis just to signify that you're taking notes about what was said in like a tweet. It is used usually when someone finds like a new information that could be useful in the future. So they just like write it down, take notes and signify it with the emoji. But I would probably give it to both Shane and Ryan because they were on the edge of getting it right.
That's where I like to live, on the edge of getting it right.
Next one is the standing man emoji.
For me, standing man used to describe a witness can be a little awkward depending on the event that occurs. Standing man, that deal Ryan made with the devil.
Similar, I wrote, it's like to frame something that's being said as truly bizarre. i.e. Annie, the producer of this video, has seen the movie Dunkirk 13 times. If she were to be like, I've seen Dunkirk 13 times, blah, 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 this is why it's great, and goes on a tangent, I would respond to that with just the standing man emoji, just like, because I'm just standing there listening to this maniac.
Oh, but you don't say things like that?
Oh, I'd say that all the time. Okay. My whole life could be responded to with the standing man emoji. I'm a weird guy.
I honestly have no clue. I thought it sort of looked like the, you know, I had to do it to him guy. So I just
I love that guy.
It signifies that. And then I'm just moving the plot along here. Grandma would say, I Frenched a mailman. You know I had to do it to him. I don't fucking know.
I like that guy. He's got cool shorts.
The standing man emoji generally means something that you use when you're in awkward or like uncomfortable situations. We even have like our own version because there are two screenshots of Ryan from Weird Wonderful World when he's just standing in the background. So people just use it instead of the emoji in this fandom. I would give points to Steven and Ryan because they got the like awkwardness. The final emoji is the combination of box emojis in a very specific order.
What the fuck?
Almost done.
Less talking, more writing.
Less jaw, more paw.
Those founders of Watcher are lucky they hired such a great staff like Simone because bugs.
Because bugs.
I think this is when someone is going a little too wild, you know, like, bro, you just snorted a double of Tito's, you're bugging.
Don't be snorting, don't be butt chugging.
No, don't be boofing.
I don't know at all, I have no idea. I said, TFW, two crickets are eating two mosquitoes' asses. I.e., the slugs in grandma's shed have some new roommates and they're extremely horny, shaking my damn head.
Damn, dude, that's a voluntary human centipede.
The box emoji mean that you kind of throw it back because you can see that the mosquitoes have like a butt up and down. So it kind of means something like twerk.
I see.
So it gotcha. Kind of means that you like dance. For the observation, I would give Shane half a point.
I'll take that.
That's fair. I think I think that's fair.
Half an ass point.
And the winner with 6.5 points is Shane.
Yeah, it's fine. That's fine. Congratulations. Put it there, partner.
Oh, I thought you were gonna do it too slow.
No, dude, I'm not nasty. I'm not a nasty boy.
That's nice of you.
Hold on. For the bigger reveal, who's in second place? Who's in last place?
Now there's gonna be a power of friendship coming back to Watcher headquarters because Steven and Ryan are tied with 4 points.
No!
It's unfortunate, it's unfortunate.
A tiebreaker in this case, they will pick their own emoji and try to assign a meaning to it as if it was a Gen Z slang that we actively use. So we'll see who's gonna be the ultimate loser.
See, that's where you're wrong, Simone. There are no losers today because we all learned something.
That's right.
Okay, I got the do with the trash can emoji. And this is an emoji used when you make a great comeback and you dunk on them.
When I saw you write the trash can emoji, I thought you were gonna go in the opposite direction where someone posts like a shitty take and you're like,
that's a trash
can. That's garbage.
I actually picked out the beaver emoji. I don't know if I'm gonna win with this, but I do want this to become popular. So I offered some 4 possible explanations.
4?
Yeah.
Okay.
Number one, we got, you know, setting up shop like, oh man, I'm nesting. This is my home. I'm building a dam. Oh, you posted pictures of your new house purchase? Beaver emoji. You're really setting up shop over there.
I like that.
Number two, like a stamp of approval because you know they got those chunky tails that are just like, you know, like I'm a, if I was a beaver, I would be like a postman because I would stamp shit.
Yeah, if you had a tail, that is how you'd express approval.
I would
just give it a big thwap, right?
It'd be like when girls go like this, except I'd be.
You'd be slapping.
I'd be slapping that chunky tail. Number three, obviously, busy. You know, a busy beaver, you're a busy guy.
Wow.
Wow, look, I'm doing a lot of work right now. Beaver emoji. And this one is NSFW.
Oh.
Let's just say it. It's a slang for a
okay.
Because, okay.
Well, the other
well, because beavers eat wood.
The other three really really charming.
If you were like, damn, dude, like
okay.
What happened at the party last night?
I think
beaver
we got
emoji.
Yeah.
You said it all in one emoji.
Simone, take it away. What's your judgment here?
Ryan, you did really a lot. I just don't think it's realistic for people to understand what a beaver emoji means in any context whatsoever. I do think that Steven's emoji kind of has the meaning somewhere in it, And you could like deduce it by yourself, like what does it mean? So I would give the final point to Steven.
Hey!
That's fair.
Ryan, I would have given it to you, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, you know, genius is often misunderstood in its time.
As the person who got the least amount of points, I'm not gonna say he's a loser. He did lose, that's a fact. And now he has to read the statement that we prepared for him.
Let's see what it is. Oh, I think I know what it is. That's pretty funny. The Pixar animated film Cars 2006 is an immaculate film with memorable characters.
That's a good Mater.
It's a good Mater.
This guy always does the best Mater impression.
That's true.
Should we do this again? Should we do millennials guess
1920s slang?
Yeah.
That's most of Shane's vocabulary.
Thanks for watching.
Oh, I was rubbing this all in. See you later, everybody.